Hi, and welcome to my talk about Etnaviv Status Update 2021 edition. If you don't know this lovely guy in front of you, my name is Gmeiner Christian, and I'm a long-term Etnaviv developer. So, let's get started. I want to start with some personal warning. I'm mostly presenting here my point of view, my thoughts about Etnaviv, how the last year was going, what is coming. And if some company, etc., is working behind closed doors on stuff that I'm not aware of, I sadly cannot present it. So let's start with a basic overview for everybody who does not know what Etnaviv is. Etnaviv is an open source graphics driver which supports embedded GPUs from Vivante, and all the work is done through reverse engineering. Etnaviv was upstreamed in Mesa 17.0, and we support, let's call it support, a wide range of different GPU models. The nice thing about the Vivante GPUs is that it is quite easy to get them working. Mostly all the hard work is done to get the kernel, to get it at the kernel level right, to get your power, clock gating, interrupt stuff working. And the chances are quite high that you get a quite nice out of the box experience with Etnaviv. So let's talk about the current state as of today. It's not that easy. We still do not have access to any official documentation about how the GPU is working, about the instruction set architecture. Also, we are not that many developers working on Etnaviv, which is quite sad. And I'm not really sure where the big problems are that other people are joining us. I think it could be the documentation, but yeah. Also, I think thanks to COVID, a lot of companies stopped their efforts in supporting the work we are doing financially. And so I need to say that for me personally, Etnaviv was downgraded to be just another hobby that, needs to split my free time. So it's just a hobby for me. So my involvement got a little bit less during this year. Nevertheless, there was some work done during the last year, and I would like to start on the kernel side. I don't remember, 2 or 3 weeks ago, Lukas Stach from Penguitronics finally was able to fix some really wild MMU issues where the state of the MMU, the GPU sees, and the GPU managers are not the same and run into a lot of troubles. And I'm really thankful that Lukas did a nice job to fix these issues. Then on the kernel side, there was some new entries to support some variants of the GC7000 models. In the kernel, we have something called like a hardware database where we can get the details which features are supported if we cannot trust the register values returned by the GPU model. And also there was some basic maintenance around the DRM subsystem. On the Mesa side, there was a little bit more exciting stuff that landed. We were able to add DRM shim support, which is a really nice thing because it enables you to run the full compiler stack, shader compiler stack on a normal development machine where you don't have a Vivante GPU in it. So this is a very helpful thing if you do, or if you're into compiler development for Etnaviv. Then we were able to land the shader compiler cache to speed up the starting of games, for instance. We were able to add the so-called NTE support. This enables us to expose more fragment and vertex samplers if the GPU supports it. Then there were fixes all over the place. We have fixes for AlphaBlend, for Depth and Standstill. There were some locking fixes done by a developer. And also we are doing basic maintenance these days because, you know, NIR and Scalium are quite fast moving targets these days. So yeah, you need to keep up with the speed of development there. And also we had some NIR stuff, but I will talk in more detail a little bit later. So let's start with one very important thing, continuous integration. These days, everybody wants to have some kind of CI integration as it allows you to have more testing of patches of merge requests in an automatic way. Before you have a CI, you need to do manual testing and check if the behavior is equal on all supported GPU models and you do not introduce any regressions. And for this, I started to look into this topic about a year ago. And I think it's finally time for an Aetna-Wiv CI solution that is based on bare metal solution from FreeDesktop. On my side, the GitLab run is running in an Android installation. I'm using a dedicated setup with a CR2Net to have the console logging. I have an Ethernet-based power control. So here we see a picture about a year ago that I showed last XTC. The setup is basically the same. I have more devices to test and the whole CI farm moved to another room. So what is missing to get live with CI? I'm happy to say, as of yesterday, there are no showstoppers anymore. There is an official merge request to integrate Aetna-Wiv into Mesa's CI landscape. And I hope to land this merge request in the next few days. So to the next topic, NIR. Everybody wants a NIR compiler these days. And we have some problems on Aetna-Wiv side. The biggest problem, the original author of the NIR compiler is not active anymore. And the result is that the maintenance is quite hard, that nobody is really into it to fix problems, to rework the overall architecture of the compiling stack. We are triggering some NIR validation problems because we are doing funny things with NIR instructions. And as a result of this, there was a start of some cleanup and refactoring work. And you might think that a refactoring process is stupidly simple and everybody can do it and it does not take that much time. But it is a lot of work to do this refactoring stuff. In the end, it looks like this. You try to run ShaderDB with DRM shim and capture the generated shader code with some statistics about number of instructions, used uniforms and stuff like this. Then you try a really simple refactoring step, like taking out, 10 lines and push it into a separate function so that you can easily write unit tests for it. You rerun the ShaderDB stuff and everything falls apart. You now have 10 times of instructions, you use 2 times of uniforms, and now the fun part starts. You need to dig into the NIR optimization passes that are happening. You need to check the ordering of the passes. You need really to understand what's the problem. When you figured out what's wrong, and you fix it in your code, it's time, usually for me, to write unit tests to keep it working over time. Because, you know, the refactoring process happens a lot of times. There's a repeating process. When you're happy with your results, unit tests are passing, usually you need to then run some real world conformance tests. Usually I run DPQ and Piglet to be sure that I do not introduce any regressions. And as I told you before, this is a quite time-consuming task to clean up the overall architecture. So this process takes some time. But there are benefits doing this that way. In the meantime, since the last year, we landed a lot of cleanups. There were crash fixes. There were really bad crashes when running Piglet with the near compiler backend. We were able to move the near-based rectangle texture lowering from Aetnaviv out in the state tracker and converted VC4 to UC2. We were able to land some compiler optimizations, and I think it is now really time to make it the default, because I often get asked by other people when I enable near as default compiler backend for Aetnaviv. And I think now it's the time. I hope there are not too much regressions out there in the wild, because I cannot test everything, but I think it is really now time. So as I got then a little bit bored with this near stuff, with this refactoring cycle I'm doing, I started to look into another very interesting topic. It's called EtherSpec. It's quite the opposite in the compiler stack. It's the low-end layer, which deals with the instruction set architecture, compilers, assemblers, and stuff like this. And I'm quite sure Friduino uses this. In the end, it is a way to describe your Ether with XML-based files, and it generates for you a disassembler, an assembler, more or less decoding and encoding of the instruction set. So this is really, really helpful, as by now there are some unknown bits in the Vivante Ether spec. So yeah, there was one little problem. EtherSpec was designed for Friduino, which has a maximum bit set size of 64 bits. That is not enough for Aetnaviv. We need 128 bits for our instruction set. We have also a fixed size instruction set, but the size is much bigger. So we need to fix this. And there is now a merge request to improve EtherSpec in that way that we can reuse EtherSpec for Aetnaviv. I hope that this merge request also lands quite soon and that the Aetnaviv-specific Ether XML file will follow shortly afterwards. But this merge request is now open for more than some weeks, and I really hope to push this forward and by talking publicly about it. So, what might be the future bring for Aetnaviv? As I told you, I'm really into now kicking off the DGSI compiler and switching to NIR, as it is the only way out of this disaster. I need to maintain at the moment two compiler backends, and that's not going to work, especially since Aetnaviv is more a hobby now. There's still hope to land to have anytime soon Glass 3 support. But my main focus for the next months is more or less to fix or emulate broken stuff or missing stuff on the current features that we have. I want to have a nice baseline I can build up onto. I'm not interested in throwing in some Glass 3 features in a hacky way, because I think that is not going to work in the long run, because I really want to have a nice maintainable driver with a lot of unit testing in it to keep it stable and not regressing that fast. That's more or less it from my side. If you're interested into Aetnaviv development, please join our IRC channel and get involved. We really need more manpower.